Praise God. Hallelujah. Well, I know that Pastor Roy has probably also had some series of messages that he's been giving you. But we started a series some time ago, and we want to be able to complete that series. And last time, Michelle was able to preach and share continuation at the time that I wasn't able to come because I got stranded out in Waterloo. But praise God, we were safe. And so anyway, we were talking about the purpose, our purpose in life. And we've taken that message from Rick Warren's book on the purpose-driven life, and we've just revisiting, you know, just looking at our purpose in life. And the first thing that we've learned in the message, the first purpose in life is to love God. We talked about that. He created you to worship Him. And then the second purpose that we shared was in life is to belong and love His family, the family of God. So you are to fellowship with other believers. We are to love the family of God. So not only do we love God, but we have to love the family of God. And the third purpose that we learned, and that's when Michelle came and preached that message, was to become more like Christ. You are to grow in discipleship. God calls us to become more like Him. As we give our lives to God, we are to love Him, we are to love our family, and then we are to grow and mature in discipleship and to become more like Him. Today, we will study the fourth purpose in life. And the fourth purpose is that you were shaped for serving God. We are here today, we are shaped for serving God. And that's what we're here. That's another purpose that we have in life. So not only that we are to love God, not only that we are to love the family of God, not only that we are to become more like Him, but as we're becoming more like Him, as we are created to become like Christ, God has shaped us to serve Him, to serve God. So we're going to look at that today, and that will be, today will be the conclusion of our purpose series of messages. And we're going to look at Ephesians chapter 2, verse 10 as our passage this morning, this afternoon. It says here, we are God's workmanship, created, you can see that, created in Christ Jesus to do good works, which God prepared in advance for us to do. Now, if you have your Bibles, I think you should underline those key words, that you are created in Christ and that you are prepared. It was prepared by God for you to do good work. So this is something God already prepared for you. So do you know what that is? Because if God prepared it for you, it's important for us to know what that is. Before you were ever born, God already prepared you to serve. This is what the scripture says. Before you were born, He already prepared in advance for you to serve. He shaped you and created you for good work. And if you imagine yourself as being the clay and God is the potter, He is shaping you, He is forming you. And when He did that, He gave you the gifts, the talents, and everything is for you to be able to serve. You are not put here on earth just to consume, but to contribute. You are not put here just to take up space. We are not just taking up space on this earth. You are placed on earth to make a difference. And here's what Job said. Job said in Job chapter 10, verse 8, he said that, your hands shaped me and made me. So Job recognizes that God was the one who shaped him, molded him, and created him. So what does that mean? That means that God created you for a purpose. When He shaped you, He created you for a purpose. You are uniquely made for a purpose and a role that only you can fulfill. Imagine that. So if God made you uniquely you, then it makes sense that you don't compare yourself with others. Isn't that true? I mean, because God created you, He created. And I'm sure, you know, if some of us here are thinking, well, I'm really not that great, you know, I'm not much, or I could never really achieve this, and I'm not. Listen, God did not make a mistake when He created you. when he made you. You're not a mistake. Tell the person beside you, you're not a mistake. All right? You're not a mistake. God shaped you according to what he wanted you to be. So, you know, God uniquely made you. You were created with talents and abilities and gifts. But your talents and gifts are not to benefit you, but to benefit others. Your talents were not given to you just so that you can have a good time. In fact, they were given to you so that you can serve other people. Look what the scripture says in 1 Peter chapter 4, verse 10. It says that each one should use whatever gift is received to make a lot of money. Oh, that's not what it says. I thought that's what it said. Each one should use whatever gift is received to serve others. So it's not for us to receive all these gifts and I'm really talented, I've got this gift, so I can make a lot of money. No, it says, use this gift to serve others. So this is what God wants for us. He didn't say for us to make a lot of money, but to serve others. And so therefore, the first purpose that we have in life is to serve God by serving others. That is really our purpose. To serve God by serving others. You know, there are a lot of people who will say, I want to serve God, but they don't want to serve others. You know, I love God, I want to serve God, but I don't want to serve other people. Well, the only way you can serve God is through serving others. Amen? So if we love God, we want to serve Him. If we want to serve Him, the only way we can do that is we serve God through serving other people. That's what God wants for us. That is called ministry. Right? That's called ministry. What is ministry? Anytime you use your gift to serve somebody else, in the name of Jesus, is called ministry. That's your ministry. Anytime you're serving others in the body of Christ, you are ministering. In the Bible, ministering and serving is the same word. That's what it means. What comes to your mind when you hear minister? When you hear minister, you probably think of a pastor or a priest or a clergy, somebody like that. But in fact, when you become a Christian, believer, you are a minister. The whole vision, in fact, the whole vision, that's why in CLC, the whole vision is for every member to be a son and to be a minister. Because a minister is one who serves others. We even teach that in our theme life course. Not every Christian is a pastor, but every Christian is a minister. You know, tell the person beside you, you're a minister.
You're a minister.
Right? So that's why we have these ministries. This is where we serve, right? Everyone in the ministry are ministers. We are all ministering, serving, okay? Every Christian needs a ministry in the church and a mission in the world. Ministry is to the body of Christ and mission is to the world. God didn't just create us just to serve, but He gave us also a model to serve. So he created us and said, all right, you know, you can, I want you to serve. I've prepared this in advance for you, but I'm going to give you a model on how you can do that. Jesus came not only to die for sinners, but he came to show us how to serve God. He also showed us how to serve God. He said, I'm the model. Watch how I do it. Look what he says in Matthew 20, verse 28, reading from the Living Bible. He said, this is what Jesus said, your attitude must be like my own. For I did not come to be served, but to serve. So this is what Jesus is saying. So he is the model for us to be servant. How to be serving is to be like Jesus, because God cares about your attitude. Your giftings reveal your ministry, but your attitude reveals your maturity. Let me say that again. Your giftings reveal your ministry, what you're serving under, but your attitude, how you serve, reveals your maturity. I know a lot of talented people who are very gifted, but they're spiritually immature. And their character is immature. That's the reason why here at CLC, we don't just want you to serve just because you have these giftings and talents.
Yes, we recognize that, but we also want you to have the right attitude. We also care about your character because that is what God wants for us. God also wants you to have an attitude of servanthood for ministry. He created us to serve, but He wants us to serve in the right way. He wants us to be like His Son. And so therefore we need to learn how to serve like Jesus. So we need to learn to serve like Jesus. Why is this important? Because so many people is looking for self-esteem. And they're running around trying to find their self-worth. Have you ever heard some people say, I'm trying to find myself? You know, they're trying to find their self-worth. And friends, you don't find your self-worth or self-esteem in your status. You don't find it in your career. You don't find it in your wealth. You don't find it in your salary. You don't find it in your success. You know, because somebody will always do better than you. So if you think, you know, I'm trying to do this, I'm going to have my self-esteem, I'm going to have my self-worth by comparing myself with others, let me tell you something, you will be disappointed because there will always be somebody better than you, more successful than you, more money than you, you know, has more possessions than you, and you will be, and you will feel like nothing. And so that's why our self-esteem is not through those things. Our self-esteem, you'll find your self-esteem through your serving God. The greatest satisfaction you have is serving God by serving others. You know, you might be saying, well, Pastor, you know, we're already serving the Lord. And why do you have to share that? You know, we're already servants. And yeah, praise God, that's good. But you know what? It's always important to talk about serving. You know why? Because first of all, that is a purpose that we have and we need to talk about it. But also because it's easy in North America, here in Canada, to just get so busy that you have no time to serve. And we forget the purpose that we have. And so it's so important to talk about it. So how do we serve like Jesus? Number one is that serving like Jesus means being available. Serving like Jesus means being available. That's how we serve like the Lord. Do you know that the Lord always made Himself available? Here's a story in Matthew 20, verse 30 to 32. There were two blind men, and you know, the story goes along, and they shouted, Lord, have mercy on us. And Jesus stopped and called them, what do you want me to do for you? Now this is Jesus. This is Jesus. You know, walking, every time Jesus performed a miracle, you'll find in the Gospels that it came as a result of an interruption. Jesus was always going somewhere. He was always walking somewhere, and always somebody would come and they would ask for help. And Jesus will be interrupted. And we know that these blind men were healed. Throughout the Gospels, Jesus was always having these miracles, performing miracles, and serving others, but it came as an interruption. And Jesus didn't mind the interruption because He loves people. Now, if you really want to serve God, you must be willing to be interrupted. How do you know if you have a servant heart? It is in how you handle interruption. Do you get upset when you get interrupted? You're just on the way, you're doing something, and then somebody interrupts you. You know, we're human, and sometimes we get interrupted. And in the way of serving others, you know, sometimes we're already trying to serve, and then somebody interrupts us, and then we get uptight. We may get upset. Do you get disturbed? Do you get irritated? Interruptions, my brothers and sisters, are opportunities to serve. Amen? There are opportunities. You know, in Proverbs 3, verse 28, it says this, never tell your neighbors to wait until tomorrow if you can help them now. See, so, you know, we never have to tell them, you know, tomorrow, if you can help them, now is the time that you can do it. Now, it's very difficult to be available to serve because there are some hindrances. Especially in our busy world that we live in today, there are many hindrances for us to be able to serve, to have the right attitude in serving. And so what are some of those hindrances to being available to serve? One of the hindrances, or the first barrier, would be called self-centeredness. Right? Self-centeredness. When we are just too busy for ourselves, that we don't have time to serve others. That is self-centeredness. You know, and sometimes we get so caught up with our own thing, with our own lives, that we see other things that's happening that are interruptions, and we're not available because we are just so busy with our own life. And so how can we serve others if we're just so busy with our own life? And that is self-centeredness. The number one enemy of compassion is busyness. All right? Look what it says in Philippians chapter 2, verse 4, in the Message. Forget yourself long enough to lend a helping hand. Forget yourself long enough. So don't be self-centered. You know, forget yourself so that you can help somebody else. You know, when we say, you know, don't bother me, you know, we're really thinking about ourselves because we are being interrupted by other people. Don't put a sign on the door of your heart that says do not disturb. That's being selfish. That's being self-centered. We cannot serve like Jesus if we are not available. And because Jesus made himself available, and these hindrances that comes in our way, one of them is self-centeredness. And the other barrier or hindrance is perfectionism. Perfectionism. You know, that's when all of the situation, when everything is perfect, then I can serve. When my kids have grown up, then I will serve. When I finish school, then I will serve. When my job is better, then I'll serve. You know, Pastor, when I just, you know, I just get this thing finished, then I will serve. I've heard so many of those from people. Oh, when I'm just going to make this deal, when I finish this deal and I just win this, you know, I will be able to serve. You know, and we keep waiting for that perfect time when everything is just fine. You know, someday I will do this. Real service, brothers and sisters, will do whatever they can with whatever they have now. That's real service. You know what it says in Ecclesiastes 11, verse 4? Take it from Solomon. Here's what he said. If you wait for perfect condition, you'll never get anything done. If you wait for perfect condition, because you know what? There is no perfect condition to serve. There is no great time that, you know, when everything is just right, then, you know, I don't have this anymore and I don't have that anymore, then I will be able to serve. But you know what? There is no perfect time to serve. You just go ahead and begin. Because Jesus, he made himself available. So it's not perfect, you know, we cannot be perfect in every situation. It doesn't have to be even perfect for God to bless it. If God would only use perfect people, what will get done? Nothing. Because nobody's perfect. Right? So, the second barrier is perfectionism. And the third one, or the third hindrance to being available, is materialism. You know, if we want to be available, we cannot be materialistic. That's when you are so caught up in just building wealth. Are you building wealth, or are you building the kingdom of God? That's a question that we should ask ourselves. Because Jesus asked the question, or made a statement in Luke chapter 16, verse 13. He said this, no servant can serve two masters. You cannot serve both God and money. You cannot. Making money should not be your number one goal of your life. That is not your purpose. God will not ask you in heaven, let me see your bank account. Or he's not going to ask you, what is your net worth? If you made good investments in real estate, he's not going to ask you about that. He's not going to care how many houses you bought or you built. He's not going to care how much money you have that you've gone on vacations or whatever. He's not going to do that. The question he'll ask is, did you build his kingdom or did you build your wealth? Wow. That's the question. You see, he didn't say you should not. He said you cannot serve both God and money. In other words, you know, he's not saying that, you know, that we cannot build wealth. He's not saying that we cannot make or earn money. No, he's not saying that. He's saying, though, that you cannot serve both. What we need to understand is that there's a God. We need to put him first in everything. So materialism is definitely a hindrance to serving God. Here's something to think about. If you have a job that is making you too busy, that you cannot make a contribution to serve in any capacity, then you're too busy. Then you deal with God about it. Let me give you a tip. God also is on your favor. He doesn't want you to live that way. So if you will pray and ask him to get you out of that situation, he will. The problem I found is some Christians enjoy doing it. And they stay in that situation. It is okay to be temporary. I know what it's like to come in a country and you come in and we have to provide and we have to make due and make sure that, you know, we'll be able to earn an income to be able to pay our bills and all of that. That's important. We need to do that. And there's a temporary situation that we gotta do that. But when you start enjoying that, looking for more overtime, you know why? Because you have bigger TV, bigger, more expensive car. And so I gotta work some more and get more income so that I can pay for all of those things. And then we're now looking for more overtime rather than cutting overtime. Are you hearing? And then we wonder why we can't serve God. Well, we created it. It is materialism. Let's call it what it is. It's different when you have needs, but when you create needs in a situation where you cannot contribute to the kingdom of God, that you cannot serve others, you've lost the purpose of why you exist. And therefore, we need to ask God to get us out of that situation. And I always counsel many believers, and I said to them, have you ever prayed? When they tell me, you know, Pastor, I don't have time because, you know, I'm working this shift and this shift. You know, that's okay in the first 5 years you're in Canada. But if you've been here 15, 20 years and you're still in the same situation, there's a problem. Maybe you have not prayed and asked God to get you out of that situation. Maybe you like doing that. Are you hearing me? Because in every situation where we've said, remember, I remember the time when Sunday, if you've been here long enough in Canada, Sunday, there was no work. How many of you remember that time? There was no work. See, there was a few here. There was no work on Sunday. You didn't have to work. People weren't open on Sunday. And then all of a sudden, retailers started opening on Sunday. And then they start asking even the believers who are at their work to start working. And so we had problems with our Christian believers. They would say, you know, Pastor, my employer would ask me to work because I'm working in the retail. And I said to them, listen, first of all, have you prayed and asked God to get you out? No, not yet. Well, let's pray. Pray that God will take you out. And then talk to your employer. And you know what? Every time they did that, God gave them a time off. Why? Because they didn't want to be in that situation. See, so you can. It's possible. It's like praying for healing. That God would heal you. This same situation, if you don't like that job that is keeping you away from serving the Lord, pray that God will take you out and give you a better one. Amen. Amen. How can he give you a better one if you never asked for it? You just keep working and working. Right? So important. But that's materialism. You know, so let's not get too busy working that we don't have time to contribute in the kingdom of God. Because God did not put you here just to make money. Amen? God did not put you here to make money. The second thing that we need to look at of how we serve the Lord, serving like Jesus means being thankful. Means being thankful. You see, Jesus had a habit of being grateful in advance. He always thanked the Lord. You know, when he performed the miracle, you know, with the 5,000 people, you know, 5,000 men, of course, with women and children, if they say there's probably about 10,000 people there. But how he performed that miracle, he first gave thanks for the 5 loaves and 2 fish. That's the way God performs a miracle. He's always thankful in advance. You know what it says in John chapter 11, verse 41 to 42? Jesus looked up and said, "Father, I thank you that you have heard me. I knew that you always hear me, but I said this for the benefit of the people standing here." Imagine what Jesus did. Sa Tagalog, nagparinig. Right? He said, "I did this for the benefit of the people standing here." Jesus could have prayed in silence. But you know what? He prayed out loud for us to hear and be able to read it in his word today. How he was thankful to God. We need to learn how to be grateful. To serve like Jesus is to be thankful for what he's done for us. You see, Jesus did miracles with gratefulness in advance. And so you and I should be always thankful. We should always serve the Lord with thankfulness. It is not a burden to serve. Are you hearing me? It's not a burden. If you are feeling burdened, maybe you are feeling like a slave, not a son. Because a son does it with joy and serves the Lord with joy. So it's not a burden, you know, to serve the Lord and to serve others. You know, some people said, you know, it's nice to serve God except the people. How can you do that? You know, ministry would be nice if it weren't for the people. That's not right. Because the people are the people of God. We serve God through serving people. It's not a burden to serve you. To serve the people of God. It's not a burden to serve the children of God. Yes, we could get tired. Yes, we could get weary. And we could ask for strength to God to give us strength. And we could get tired. But it should not be a burden. We could still have the joy of serving and serve with gladness. Here's what it says in Psalm 100, verse 2. In the King James, it says, "Serve the Lord with gladness." Serve the Lord with gladness. Tell the person beside you, "Serve the Lord with gladness." You know why? Because the Lord gave himself for us. Here's what it says in 2 Timothy chapter 1, verse 9. "It is he who saved us and chose us for his holy work, not because we deserved it, but because that was his plan." God already did this for us. He served willfully, willingly, and he did it with gladness in his heart. He was thankful to God for the privilege of dying on the cross for us. And you know, the Bible even says that for the joy, he endured the cross. It's for the joy of dying for us. Imagine that. It was joyful to him to do this for us. It should not be a burden for us to serve. If the Lord to him is not an interruption from heaven coming down to serve us, die for us, it was not an interruption for him because he loves us. And so we must have the same attitude to love the Lord. There are things that could hold us back from being grateful. You know that there are some things that hinder us from being grateful. You know what the first barrier is? Criticizing and comparing. That's one of the barriers, is criticizing and comparing. You know, that holds us from being grateful. Instead of being grateful, we will criticize and we compare. It says in Romans 14:4, "Who are you to criticize someone else's servant? The Lord will determine whether his servant has been successful." So you and I, we don't have to criticize others in other ministries, whatever they're doing. We don't criticize, you know, other servants of the Lord, what they have done. The Lord will be the one to determine whether it's successful or not. Let us just be grateful. We shouldn't compare ourselves with other people. That's ridiculous, because you know what? We're all on the same team. We're all servants together. We don't need to compare one another. We cannot criticize one another. We, you know, when we do that, when we criticize and compare, that holds us back from being grateful. Accepting, and you're thankful for it. Another barrier for being grateful is wrong motivation. When we have the wrong motivation, motivation such as, you know, I do this so that you can see me. You know, I will outperform so that you can see. I'll serve because somebody will. I want to serve because somebody is looking. They can see me serving. That's not the good way. That's not the right way to serve. That's not being grateful. It says in Matthew 6:1, when you do good deeds, don't try to show up. If you do, you won't get a reward from your Father in heaven. We don't do good deeds that other people can want. Remember this. Whatever we're doing, God sees it. Amen? So if you're a servant of the Lord, just keep serving God. Don't do it with a wrong motivation. Just be grateful for the opportunity that you can serve the Lord. That's a great motivation to serve God. What an opportunity. And lastly, serving like Jesus means being faithful. Serving like Jesus means being faithful. Faithful means you don't give up when you get discouraged. You continue. You persevere because you are faithful. Jesus, at the end of his ministry, here's what he said in John 17, verse 4. He said to his Father, I have brought you glory on earth by completing the work you gave me to do. See, that's what God wants us to be able to say about you. That's what God wants to say about you and I, that when at that day, we will be able to complete the work that we have done, and that we have finished the job. That's what he wants us to be able to say. Yeah, Father, I have completed the work. That you complete the work that God gave you to do here on earth. My question to each one of us is, are we completing the work that God has given to do? Do we even know what we're supposed to do? Because, friends, if that's our purpose in life, then we need to know what God has prepared for us. That we complete the work that God gave us to do. That's being faithful. That we don't give up along the way. You know, that if God has called you to be a Sunday school teacher, that you're going to be teaching, you don't quit in the middle. You finish the term. If you're supposed to serve for 1 year, be committed to serve 1 year. Amen. Don't give up. Being faithful means, this is my commitment. I'll be faithful to that. I will finish and complete the work. This is my purpose. God has given me an opportunity to serve the children or to serve in a ministry. Maybe I'm a life group leader or a Sunday school teacher or maybe an usher. Whatever God has given me, I'm going to complete it. If I have 1 year to have made a commitment for a year, I'm going to complete it. That's being faithful. Amen? That's what God wants for us. The one thing that is required is not that you be talented. The one thing required is that you are faithful. Because there are many who are talented, but they're not faithful. It's better, you may not have all the talents, but if you're faithful, God will equip you to be talented. Not that you do it perfect, but that you do it. That means you never retire in serving. Amen? You know, when people say to me, oh, Pastor, are you going to retire someday? And I say, you know what? When I look at Billy Graham, I feel bad about retiring. Because Billy Graham has not retired. He's still preaching. He's still doing the work. I mean, your service could change. Maybe your ministry could change. Maybe you were doing this, and maybe that's a season that you were doing, but something else now God wants you to do. But you continue serving the Lord. Amen? You never really retire serving. You may change your ministry area. All year and night. Because where you are going, And he's talking about the end time, where you're going, you have no opportunity, sir. You can't do that anymore. When the last trumpet is called, that's it. You have no more opportunity to serve. But today, everything that we do counts. Everything counts. Small things may be significant. There's a difference between prominence and significance. Prominence can be seen, but significant is important. Are you hearing me? You know, there may be small things that you're doing, but it's very significant. It may not be prominent, like preaching is prominent. You can see it. But there are things that is not prominent, but very significant. For example, in our physical body, you know, my nose is prominent. You can see it. My face is prominent. But you know what? My heart is very significant. If that stops, even though you don't see my heart, it's not prominent. But if that stops, I'm dead. Right? So there are things that you don't see, they're not prominent, but very significant. In the body of Christ is the same. There are ministries, there are people serving in the body of Christ that may not be prominent, but they're very significant. I couldn't do what I do here without the people who are serving behind the scenes. For example, if they don't like me, they could cut my mic. And you don't know who. And then I can't, then people won't be able to hear me. They won't publish it on the video, and they won't put it on the internet, and that's it. But you see, there are people behind the scene that we don't even know. So sometimes you may think, well, I'm really insignificant because I don't really have this kind of ministry. I'm not expressive. I'm not that person that can go up in the front. You don't have to. Because you may be able to serve in a very significant capacity, even a small thing, even behind the scene, is a significant thing. Are you hearing me today? The things that are prominent may not be significant. But there are things that sometimes behind the scene that we do in the body of Christ. You know that there was a story about the usher and the two boys. There were two boys that came into a conference one time, and the preacher was preaching at that time, and the two boys came in and they looked and they kind of, you know, they were shy because they were kind of late. They were just passing by, and the usher, you know, instead of saying, "Ooh, get out of here because you're just making... you're just disturbing." You know what the usher said? "Okay, don't worry, come. I'm going to find you a seat." You know, while the preacher was preaching, and they found a seat, and the usher ushered that person, and that person got born again. One of those boys got born again, and he's Billy Graham today. Imagine that. You'll never know what you could have done. You'll never know one of the Sunday school that you taught could be a Benny Hinn or, you know, one of these great evangelists that we hear today. You never know. Someone that you just served that came in, you never know who you have served. And so sometimes it may seem that it's very insignificant that we're doing, but it's something in the kingdom of God. Anonymous doesn't mean unnecessary. Just give you a little quiz. Do you know the people doing things behind the scene in our church? Do you know them? You know, do you know the Sunday school teachers that you don't see, but they're down there every Sunday teaching behind the scene? Do you know the people that are recording back there? You know, doing the setup, the microphone, you know, arranging stuff, you know, doing the PowerPoint. Do you know them? You know, the people that are driving people back and forth if there is a life group or there's an event. Do you know them? These are people just behind the scene. We don't know them. They may seem, you know, not prominent, but very significant. Friends, all of these things that we see that are just behind the scene are done by anonymous volunteers. But you know what? They're significant in the kingdom of God. Amen? First of all, let's give them a hand. They're not recognized because they're just behind the scene. But they labor just as well as those that are prominent. See, God, friends, you are here at CLC forever. God brought you here to make a difference. God brought you here because you have something that this church needs. You know, you have probably some of you that have joined our church. You were praying, God, you know, use me. God, use me. And the Lord brought you here. Now, are you being used? You know what I'm saying? If you've been praying, God, use me. And then the Lord sent you here because God wants to use you here. You have a gift. You have a talent. You have something that God, you have an ability that God needs in this church. And so that's why you're here. So did you discover that purpose? If you prayed about it and God sent you here, see, you have a purpose why you are here. Amen. You may say, well, they don't need me. They got everything. No, did that mean that God made a mistake in bringing you here? No. I don't think God made a mistake. I believe God answered your prayer and our prayer because we pray. God, send the workers. Amen. We pray, Lord, send the workers. That's a good prayer because the Lord said, always pray because the harvest is ripe. It's already white. You know, it's already there. But we need workers. Pray to send workers. Now, God sent the workers. So you are a worker. Just, you know, just be used by the Lord. Amen? You know, and if you think, well, they don't need me, maybe I'm insignificant, there's nothing much more to do because are a lot of people already meeting the needs. Well, just go with me for a day. And I will show you all of the things that is still not being met. There are still a lot of needs in the church that are not being met. And we need people like yourself who can serve. Praise God. The reason why you're here on earth is to practice for eternity. Because one day we will go before the Lord. There are options in your life. You can invest it or you can waste it. You will stand before God and you'll be asked, what did you do with what I gave you? Your talent, your abilities, your freedom, your gifts. See, not everything will last. Your career will not last. Even if you wanted to stay in your job, they will retire you. Sometimes earlier than you think. Your job will not last. Your career will not last. Your status, your wealth, your achievements will not last. Serving your ministry, serving in ministry will last, will far outlast your career. The only thing that is done for Christ will last. Everything else will not last. You may feel that nobody sees what you do, but God sees it. I want to encourage you today, those of you that have been serving, you've been serving faithfully. I want to encourage you, God sees what you do. Praise God. Here's what it says in Hebrews chapter 6, verse 10. Hebrews 6, 10. He will not forget how hard you have worked for Him and how you have shown your love to Him by caring for other Christians. You see, He will not forget what you've done. People may forget, but the Lord will never forget. Whatever you have done for people, it's already written in heaven. God sees it. And you know, the best thing that you could hear from the Lord is in Matthew 25, 21, where He can say, well done, good and faithful servant. He didn't say good and talented servant. No, being faithful. You have been faithful with a few things. So I will put you in charge of many things. Come and share your master's happiness. Friends, it's not the big thing. It's just the little thing. That God says, if you've been faithful with this little thing, you've been given a job, a task, a very small thing, but you've been faithful with that. God says, well done, faithful servant. I'm going to make you ruler of many. Sometimes we want to rule many things. But we have not learned to be faithful with the little things. Have we been faithful in serving God in the little things that He's given us? If we have been called to be an usher, were we faithful to be an usher? That we don't skip, we keep missing our opportunity to serve? If we are called to be a Sunday school teacher or somebody at the back or a greeter, Have we continued? If we're in the GIC or wherever that we're God called us to serve, if we've been called to be faithful in that area, have we continued to be faithful? Or we miss and skip and we forget and we our ministry leader have to follow up on us? You see, friends, God wants us to be faithful. And here he said, when we're faithful with the little things, God will make us ruler of men. If you're faithful to little things here in the church, in the things that God gives us, you know what? God will make you ruler even in the marketplace. Wherever you are working in the marketplace, God can use you in a greater way. See, friends, my role as a pastor is to help you to come to a point to prepare you for one day you will face God. One day you will come before God and will be able to say to you, "Well done, my faithful servant." So I encourage you, if you have been serving, praise God, continue to be faithful. If you have missed some and you've skipped some, you know, and you failed in some sometimes, then ask God to forgive you and be faithful. If you have not been serving yet, what are you waiting for? Amen. This is the time that you can serve. There's no more time to serve when we're gone. We have no opportunity. You'll never know when your time is up. And this is the time we have the opportunity to serve. Amen? You received that today? Amen. Let us pray. Will you stand with me? Father, in the name of Jesus, we thank you for your word today. Thank you, Lord, for teaching us how we should be served, how we should serve like Jesus. God, you have created us to serve others. You have even prepared what we're supposed to do beforehand, even before we were born. You have created us for good work. Help us, Lord, to fulfill that purpose in our life. Help us to seek that purpose in our life. And Lord, we pray today, continue to encourage and strengthen those of us that are serving you. And for those of us that need to serve you, Father, I pray, may you arrange their schedules to be able to serve you. I know, Father, that there are people that want to serve you, but their circumstances do not allow them. I pray today, God, help them to be able to have the right circumstances so that they can contribute to the kingdom of God, that they can serve you faithfully. Help them to be available for you, that they will not see the interruptions as something that is negative, but Lord, they will see this as opportunity to serve. So Lord, thank you for every servant here. And we thank you for those that will be serving. And we commit this time to you now as we worship you. Lord, draw us to yourself. Draw us, Lord, and help us to seek you, to continue to be faithful to you. Lord, let your spirit move upon us today. We ask this in Jesus' name. Amen. Friends, as we worship the Lord, we have an opportunity today to just come before God. Some of us are serving the Lord, and sometimes we grow weary. We get tired of serving. Not because we're burdened, but because our circumstances, maybe, of what we're doing, and we need prayer. You're here today, and you want to serve God, you need prayer, you can come. We will pray with you and encourage you and strengthen you. And those of you that maybe are not serving yet because of circumstances, this is the day we can pray together that God will take you out of that situation so you will have an opportunity to serve. Don't miss your opportunity to serve God. I'm not doing it for me. I'm letting you know this is for God. You have seen the Word of God, that you were created for a purpose and to serve you. If you don't know that purpose yet, you don't know what area to serve, then come at the altar. Begin to pray and ask God what that area. And God will show you. He will reveal to you what area you should serve. And then talk to your leader. Talk to me. Talk to anyone that you can share and say, "You know, I believe, Pastor, I believe I can serve in this area. I don't know how yet, but as God enables me, I want to serve." If that's the case, just come at the altar. Lay it before God. Amen. As we worship the Lord, you can come at the altar and we will pray with you. God bless you as you come. Hallelujah. Just keep coming. We will pray with you.